Welcome to the Oral Health Care Skills web series, number 4 of 7, Basic Oral Care. I am your facilitator, Mary Lee Vanderhorst, from the Regional Geriatric Program in Hamilton, Ontario. I would like to welcome presenter Lori Hawkins from the Halton Region Health Department in Oakville, Ontario. And knowledge broker, Terry Kirkpatrick, from the Seniors Health Research Transfer Network in Ottawa, Ontario.
Hello.
We ask that you note several items. First, no photos of the patient may be copied, but permission may be requested. Secondly, this is an educational presentation to be used for learning purposes, and users of this information are responsible for adaptation of this information to their practice and work environment. We have made every effort to provide you with accurate, evidence-based, and useful information. Finally, we thank Sherton, Halton Region, and RGTC for their contributions to make possible the Oral Healthcare Skills web series. Lori Hawkins will now Series 4, Basic Oral Care.
Thank you, Mary Lou. As Mary Lou mentioned, our topic is basic oral care. And first, I want to discuss the common caregiver reluctancies to providing oral care. Oftentimes, caregivers are hesitant to provide oral care to their clients for many reasons. These reasons can include a shortage of time or not the right supplies, a fear of being bitten and experiencing challenges with client behaviors, or a lack of confidence the job is being done correctly. And also, we cannot forget about health and safety or ergonomic issues. These reluctancies are usually overcome with some easy steps and the use of new techniques. I will address these reluctancies and I will give you simple tools to use with clients in the delivery of basic oral care. Let's start with shortage of time. Ideally, oral care should be performed with your clients at least 2 times each day. This can be a challenge to keep the time of day consistent because clients are sleeping or have visitors or are just not in a cooperative mood. If a client displays behaviors and does not want brushing done at the time a caregiver asks, leave until a time more suitable for the client. As long as oral care is being done, the timing is not terribly important. However, it is important to remember that it is best to perform the nighttime oral care at a time that is shortly before any food or drink other than water will leave sugars in the client's mouth, and that can contribute to tooth decay over time. The next reluctancy caregivers often experience is not knowing what supplies to use in delivering oral care or not having the correct supplies easily available. This slide shows the basic supplies needed. The basic supplies needed are a washcloth, and be sure that it is one that is clean and only used for oral care. Also, gauze or J-cloth, and 2 toothbrushes. And we also see a bottle here, and this is Paravex gel, which is what I recommend instead of toothpaste, and there is more about that on their next slide. If you have a client who has dentures or partial dentures, then included in your basic supplies would be a denture brush as well. So it is a good idea to evaluate what supplies you have available on your unit and discuss with staff and supervisors what supplies you need to have. Many supervisors are receptive to providing additional supplies if they are asked for. Why should not use toothpaste for everyone? Well, toothpaste is not typically recommended for clients if they are not able to brush on their own. And this is because toothpaste foams up in the mouth, leaving it difficult for the caregiver to see when brushing. It also causes the client to want to spit regularly, thereby increasing the time it takes to perform the oral care. Clients can choke on toothpaste if they have a swallowing problem. And some older adults, especially those with advanced dementia, may not like the strong of some paste. Paravex is the other product that you see in the slide. It does not foam up like toothpaste, and the taste is not too strong for most people. So you may want to consider this as an alternative to toothpaste. And at the end of the presentation, there will be information on how to order Parabex. You may have noticed that there was no dental floss in the list of basic supplies. Flossing is an extremely important part of oral care. However, the challenges that our clientele face can make it difficult to impossible to floss. While nothing replaces flossing, there are alternative tools that can be used. On the left is an example of an end-tuft brush, which is a toothbrush with a small bristle head. These are excellent for cleaning hard-to-reach areas, especially in the back and around the gum line. They are also good for cleaning around bridges and implants. The small head makes it easy for the caregiver to see and remove plaque. Over on the right, this is an example of a proxy brush. Sometimes people only have one or two teeth at the very back of their mouth, and this type of brush is small and therefore can make it easier to get behind the teeth to clean. This is important because cavities can start at hard-to-reach areas because they are not being cleaned well, and this is often where food gets trapped. The other tool is a tip stimulator, and these work well to clean at the gum line and to stimulate the gum. Let me just reiterate that brushing may be the only realistic oral care that can be accomplished on some clients. So find what works and is realistic for your clients, and know that anything that you do is beneficial. When you have determined what supplies you will need to effectively clean your client's mouth, you then can gather the supplies and have the client ready in the best physical condition for them and for you as the caregiver. I will talk more about positioning your client in a few minutes, but if no special positioning is needed, you will first drape your client with a hand towel and dampen the cloth or gauze with warm water and place a small pea-sized amount of Parabex gel on the cloth or gauze. Once you have your supplies ready, you must determine what technique you will use. The mop and go technique is the best method to use if an individual has difficulty spitting. It also allows the caregiver to perform care quickly and effectively if a client is reluctant or bedbound. You simply brush a section of the mouth and then flip the brush around and place between the top and bottom teeth to ensure the client does not bite your fingers before you then mop up or remove the debris after brushing. This is where the gauze or the J cloth comes in handy. This mop and go technique can be used anywhere. It is great for the bedbound and makes it easier on the caregiver to keep the saliva and debris under control. Another reluctancy many caregivers have is the fear of being bitten. This is a real concern, and every precaution should be taken to ensure that this does not happen. As you can see in this photo, the caregiver is brushing the client's teeth with one hand and using another toothbrush in the other hand. This toothbrush is very useful. It replaces a caregiver's fingers that might have been used to retract a cheek or hold a mouth open. The best toothbrushes for this technique are the larger handled, soft ones. These work well because you can use the soft handled end for the prop, which is easier and feels better to the client than a hard, skinny handled toothbrush. These higher quality and longer lasting toothbrushes can be very reasonable to purchase directly from toothbrush companies using their institutional price list. It is important to note that all toothbrushes should be replaced every 3 months or after an illness to prevent reinfection. If you have a client with dentures or partial dentures, then you have some additional steps that you need to take. First, remove the denture. You will want to clean the denture in a sink with a cloth so it cushions the denture in the event of dropping it in a hard sink, and brush using water or a professional denture cleaner. You should visually check the gums for sores and wipe out any plaque off tissues with cloth. And remember to remove the denture at night and place in room temperature water in a cup or denture container, or soak in a half vinegar and half water solution to remove hard deposits. Some clients do not want to have their denture removed at night, and if all you can do is to convince them to remove it for a few hours in the day, then that is better than not at all. But ideally, it should be removed at night to prevent gum irritation and infection. Please note that the vinegar and water solution should only be used with non-metal dentures, as the vinegar can erode metal dentures or partial. Here again, another good look at using the toothbrush handle to hold back a cheek. When trying to reach back teeth on the cheek side, you can simply ask the client to close their teeth together and then place the handle in the pouch section of the cheek and gently pull out the cheek. This will allow you to reach those back teeth that so often are magnets for plaque accumulation. Bite the bamboo is a technique using the extra toothbrush as something for the client to bite on. This relieves the client from having to keep their mouth open and aids the caregiver in propping the mouth open. The less amount of time asking the client to open wide, the better for the caregiver. It also removes the risk of the caregiver being bitten. The handhold. Sometimes the distraction of a second person holding a client's hand will allow the caregiver to brush the teeth. Some clients will want to grab the brush out of your hand, and this can be dangerous for you and the client. The extra set of hands definitely comes in handy, and working with a coworker while doing oral care makes up go much faster and much smoother. The hug. Here again, we see caregivers working as a team to effectively deliver oral care. The hug technique, like the handhold, gives the person doing the brushing an opportunity to get the oral care accomplished without fear of being grabbed or hit by a combative client. Sometimes the best method for cleaning a client's mouth is the bed method. Clients are already in a comfortable position, and the caregiver can access the mouth easily while the client is lying down. It is important to try to never awaken a client to provide oral care. This will likely only irritate a client, and you may not receive the compliance you need if the client becomes uncooperative. Use all the same techniques, such as the two toothbrushes and hand-holding, etc., that we have discussed, and this method is very successful and the least stressful for yourself and your client. For your clients that are in large wheelchairs, this should not be a hindrance to performing oral care. Large wheelchairs often recline, and use of the simple techniques discussed previously, good oral care is achievable. Our next reluctancy deals with the resistances of clients. Some clients, especially those with dementia, may not be very receptive to having a caregiver clean their teeth. It may be seen as an invasion of their personal space, and they respond with a verbally or physically combative behavior. Now, this can be quite a challenge for a caregiver, and the inclination to avoid a potentially uncomfortable or dangerous situation can cause a caregiver to not even try to perform the oral care. This slide discusses some that may work with your clients, like using techniques you have learned in your approach to other aspects of care. And if you've been trained in the gentle, persuasive approaches model, you may want to use those techniques in delivering oral care. Or trying to do oral care in a familiar place where familiar personal items are, you might try giving the client a rolled-up washcloth or a soft ball if their hands start grabbing. If a two-person approach is used, have only one person speaking throughout the procedure. This will keep the client focused, or distracting with music or TV may be what works for a particular client. If you are still having difficulty providing oral care on a particular individual, it is important that you record or document this in the client's file. A review and reassessment of the oral care plan may be needed to better suit the client's needs. You may ask another coworker to try to deliver the oral care, as they might have a better response. Just do not ever give up trying, because oral care problems can lead to nutrition problems, which can, of course, lead to bigger health problems. And you may find that a client's family are able to assist in oral care. If they visit daily and want to participate in their loved one's care, then this may be something that they can do, and the client may be more receptive to a daughter or a spouse cleaning them staff. It's also important to tell the physician, resident dentist, or a charge nurse if you suspect the client has a mouth infection, gum disease, or a cavity. Some clients may not be able to identify when they are in pain, and you could be instrumental in recognizing problems before they get too serious. Another area to think about when performing oral care is the safety and ergonomics of the client and yourself, the caregiver. If a client is performing their own care, be sure they have the brakes on a wheelchair or they're sitting on the walker to do the oral care. For the client that is not steady on their feet, having their supplies easily accessible is important as well. This will prevent the client from having to reach for supplies and potentially injuring themselves. For the caregiver, try to position the client so that you can access their mouth. If you are leaning over and practically standing on your head, then you know this is not good for your body either. To bring all this information together, it is important to identify where is the best place to provide care for your client. Is it in bed, in the room, or in the wheelchair? This will be something you will figure out on an individual basis with each client. What supplies are needed? Do you need the basic supplies for someone who has only natural teeth, or does your client have dentures? This, again, will be customized to your client. And finally, remember that if you are still having difficulty, talk with a charge nurse to come up with some solutions or contact a dental professional for further assistance and guidance. In conclusion, please know that the oral care you perform on clients is important. You are doing them a service by maintaining their oral health, by identifying potential risks, and simply by helping the client to feel clean and refreshed, which can certainly lead to a happier, more content individual. Oftentimes, the question arises, where can I find these tools from the slides? This slide and the next are a list of where you can find the various tools in the trade. And please note that some companies have a minimum order, so, and that this is only a sample list of the companies that provide these products. These products and others like them are also available through other companies. Thank you. For more information about oral health, please visit www.halton.ca/oral health or www.halton.ca/HOHO.
I would like to thank Lori Hawkins for the Series 4 Basic Oral Care presentation. I am your facilitator, Mary Lou Vanderhorst, and along with Lori Hawkins and Terry Kirkpatrick, our knowledge broker, we invite you to watch one of the other 6 Oral Health Care Skills Web Series. Series 1, Denture Care. Series 2, Tools of the Trade. Series 3, Oral Health Assessment. Series 5, Toothbrush Technique. Series 6, Infection Control, and Series 7, Oral Hygiene Care Planning. For more information and resources, we recommend that you go to any of the websites listed on pages 2 or 3 of this presentation.